what is the significance of Aum? Many people connect it with religion, but it is actually not. If you see, this is a common term in almost all the religious practices in the world, because it is the basis of all creation. Let me tell you a scientific fact that quantum physics states that this whole creation, this complete universe, is all but the manifestation of vibrations. Everything is moving with a very, very high speed of almost 10 raised to 23 per second. And this, if there is a vibration, there is bound to be some sound. And vice versa is also true, that if there is some sound, there is bound to be some vibration or impact because of which that sound is there. So if you see the theory, if there is a vibration, there has to be sound. And the basic three syllables of the sound of creation are A, O, and M. If you see, if you combine them all, they become Aum. That is, which is called as Om in Vedic culture or Hindi culture, Hindu culture. If you go for Christianity, they call it as Amen. Amen. They say a word Amen. Okay. And in Muslim culture, it is called as Ameen. Now, in these words, because they are the basis of the whole creation, all the preachers of the religion, it may be any, when they get in harmony with the nature, when they get sensitive to this creation, they all are in this line of Aum. We are also the creation of this Aum. If you see, when we say that it's all, the whole creation is Aum, we are also Aum, and every particle with which, every atom with which we are formed is all Aum. This is the only basic sound, A, O, and M, which you can pronounce without moving your tongue, and which every organism on this planet does. Every planet, every organism on this planet can make this sound because it does not require any effort or any change. Like, the television has three basic colors, red, green, and blue. And these make this complete spectrum of colors for us. Similarly, these are the three syllables, A, Om, and M, which form the complete creation and the complete amalgamation of sounds. And we are also a part of it. But because we are becoming insensitive to life, because of the consumption of neurostimulants or nervous stimulants, especially in the form of foods, which probably we don't know are neurostimulants. The most common example which you would know is the coffee or the tea, which has caffeine in it. It continuously keeps on stimulating our system and makes us insensitive. This is a common experiment which can be performed by anyone. You take a rod of iron or wood, hit it on your hand hard again and again. Initially, you will have pain. Later, you become insensitive. Medical students in physiology learn that if they stimulate the muscle electrically or mechanically, they use the frog's muscle, it becomes tetanized. It becomes insensitive to that stimulus and it remains in the contracted state. Same is with the nervous tissue of human beings. We are continuously stimulating it in the form of some or the other food product that we consume. May it be coffee, may it be tea in the form of caffeine in the form of tea or coffee. The chili flakes, the green chili, garlic, onion, all these are nervous stimulants. And all other intoxicants like alcohol, etc., are all nervous stimulants or depressants. If they are, the alcohol is a nervous depressant in the later stage, it is a nervous stimulant in the first and second phase. So if you see different parameters and different foodstuffs which stimulate the nervous system, which are as a result making us insensitive towards life, and that is why we are not able. Now you will say, if I put my ear to my hand, I'm not able to hear the Aum, because human hearing tendency has a range, human hearing capacity has a range. The range is 20 decibels or 40 decibels to 120 decibels to 140 decibels. Above it is ultrasonic, below is ultrasonic, and above is supersonic. So we are not able to hear the sounds which are outside this range, and that is why we are not able to hear this Aum. But if you go in the laboratory and with the radar system, you can detect that sound. And that is why, my dear friends, we just can't put this creation and the basis of this creation and bias them on the basis of religion, social aspects, etc. Yeah, I was telling you about Aum. So if you take it, see, when Ram was in Ayodhya, he was called as Ram. When he came to the South Indian part, Karnataka, it became Rama. When he came to the more South Indian part, like the Tamil Nadu or Kerala part, it became Raman. So this is the linguistic variability of Aum, which has occurred all over the world. When it is Ameen, if you remove the in, the last part, in, like it is Ameen, if you remove that in, it is Aum. If now the accent variability, if you go to United States, they call it as Amen. They call it as Amen. So if you remove the in, it's again Aum. It's all the linguistic and vocalistic variability, my dear friends. The basis of creation is all the same. And in any part of the globe, wherever one has become sensitive to this creation, one has become experiential to this creation, the word Aum has come into light because it is the basis of all creation. So there is a significant method how to pronounce it as om. In the Vedic culture or in the Hindu culture, they have just labeled these a, o and m into as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. Ukar, okar and makar. Akar, ukar and makar. So they just have named them as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. It's a spiritual belief. You can give them any name, XYZ, ABC, anything. But long back, the Rishi Munis or the Indian civilization people had already labeled them as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. But this is the basis of all creation, of all the physicality and the non-physicality, which we can see or which we cannot see, which we can experience or which we cannot experience. And this is the basis. Thank you.